Hi friends, welcome back to another episode of Generation Tech. My name is Alan. There are plenty of themes woven into Star Wars. There's the classic battle between control and freedom between the Jedi and Sith, the Empire and the Rebels. There's the internal struggle between dark and light our heroes must face within themselves. Then there's the message of hope, the shining beacon that will lead us out of our darkest moments to our greatest accomplishments. But layered throughout all of these messages and themes is the most prevalent and probably important theme of them all, something that Disney and all of the creators of the movies and films probably forgot about. I'm talking about the theme of war and conflict. And no, I'm not gonna say that it never changes because then I wouldn't be able to do this video, which is about the evolution of war and combat in Star Wars, specifically focusing on the period of time ranging from the Clone Wars to the Resistance versus First Order War, which we'll see in Rise of Skywalker. Now, what happened before the Clone Wars is equally as important to what happened during the Clone Wars. The Golden Age of the Republic brought in 1,000 years of prosperity. There's a huge focus on developing culture, art, and economic growth. It was a pretty good time to be alive, but the lack of a true threat meant that the government had to, of course, create fictional manufactured threats that they had a campaign against and pretend to fight themselves, causing a lot of political infighting and nonsense. And so brave men and women who in other generations would have been destined for the battlefields and ultimately lost to disease and death, filtered their way through life and became educators, scientists, technicians, engineers, and all other professions except being a soldier. Obi-Wan's view that blasters were crude and uncivilized was shared by the majority of people in the core of the galaxy. The possibility of war on the horizon just didn't seem to exist, which is exactly what every population thought before war came upon them. The only region of space where constant death and violence still awaited you was pretty much the Outer Rim. It was very much the frontier of the Republic, just like the West was the frontier of our American Republic. Except for the fact that Manifest Destiny in the Galactic Republic was just an ideology, not really backed by physical military force. And so the colonists of the Outer Rim were oftentimes left on their own and suffered horribly from all manners of violence and murder at the hands of bandits, aliens, and later on, overly ambitious businesses. Now, I'm not saying the American West was not a dangerous and wild place to be, but at least there's a federal military. The Galactic Republic had no federal military. This meant that the Outer Rim colonists were tough as nails. Well, the ones that survived, at least. We all know that Kleeg Lars would have kept on fighting the Sand People if he hadn't misplaced his leg. Now, some Outer Rim colonies grew into actual planets and then regional powers. Now, because there was no federal military in these areas, they actually did have to create their own regional defense forces, and so they started creating their own military technology and training their own leaders and soldiers, and they actually did develop a kind of warrior and military mentality, something that was not seen at all in the core regions of the galaxy. For instance, you had the Tarkins of Eridu, a very militaristic family that was heavily involved in the Outland region's security force, and would go on to produce some of the best military minds of the Galactic Republic and the Empire. And then there was also the Trade Federation Defense Fleet, which also created its fair share of military leaders and heroes. From a political and economic standpoint, the core regions of the galaxy could not figure out a real way to uplift the Outer Rim territories. There are too few people out in the Outer Rim and not enough commerce to sustain simple things like a security force to protect the shipping lanes. This is unless the core planets were willing to pay for it, which of course they weren't. Now, towards the end of the Golden Age, the Republic finally created a free economic trade zone in the Outer Rim in order to encourage private investors and companies to go in there and build the infrastructure, something that they were more than willing to do because ultimately they would be able to control this entire territory and do business in any way they wanted. This newfound power and self-reliance ultimately made the Outer Rims rebel in the form of the CIS, or Confederacy of Independent Systems. When the Confederacy first declared war on the Republic, millions of Confederate citizens signed up for their local defense forces because a lot of them were tired of this elite attitude they saw coming from the core region of the galaxy. Now, let's not compare this too much to the American Civil War because actually that was about slavery, whereas the Clone Wars was more focused on issues like taxation without representation. The Outer Rim was basically able to take care of itself and it had no reason to belong to the Republic, whose policies had really nothing to do with them anymore. The Severus High Command was smart enough to realize that the Outer Rim, although quite significant in their economic and raw resource output, lacked the same number of people that the core regions did. Not only did the Republic greatly outnumber the Confederacy, a civilian army also creates a lot of liabilities when it comes to your overall strategy. Massive casualties could lead quickly to war weariness and defeat, and so the CIS tapped into their great corporate connections and quickly fielded a massive droid army. The Republic had a different but similar problem. It was full of soft men and women who were used to the comforts and luxuries of the core region of the galaxy. There was no way they were going to be willing to get drafted or volunteer to fight in some massive war in the Outer Rim territories. There was also no carefully built culture that encouraged one to serve and at the same time honored a soldier's sacrifice. It would be complete political suicide for someone in the Senate to offer up their constituents to fight in this foreign war. And so the Republic too would have to look elsewhere for their military. They would not be able to draft their citizens. They were so desperate that they instead accepted a massive clone army that mysteriously appeared out of nowhere and then ordered the Jedi to lead it. So what you had was a war that featured two sides using expendable surrogates that had very little value except for what they were able to do on the battlefield. This included the Jedi and the clones, not just the extremely cheap battle droids being mass-produced by the Separatists. When the safety of combatants is not a really big issue, the tactics that are used in war become more dangerous and more extreme. For most of the war, the Confederacy attempted to create biological diseases that only affected the Fett DNA, whereas the Republic were more than happy to drop EMP devices that could wipe out all technology in massive areas. Not only were there no protests in the Republic about bringing the soldiers back home, there were actually protests to use more extreme measures so that the war would not reach their home. Fans of the series might see the clone troopers and Jedi as heroes, but in the CIS worlds, they were seen as monsters and war criminals. After the Battle of Geonosis, Separatist forces began targeting Republic worlds, both through militaristic means, but also through friendly trade and humanitarian aid. So many worlds had been neglected by the Republic that many Outer Rim territories were ready to change sides. Those who didn't bend to the CIS's will were blockaded, and ultimately, the Republic would attack en masse, trying to make their way through. The Republic actually fielded a very advanced carrier force. Their main ship of the line was the Venator, which was a hybrid carrier/star destroyer, which could carry up to 300 starfighters. The Republic's goal was always to keep the enemy at a distance and use their fighters to screen their more vulnerable capital ships. The Separatists had a fleet mostly piloted by droids. Many of their ships were actually converted merchant ships that had quickly been modified to fight the Republic. But that was okay because the fact that they didn't have living people on their ships gave them a huge advantage. A lot of these Separatist ships were more skeletal in nature. They didn't have life support or living spaces, just weapons and shield generators. A lot of them. At far ranges, the Separatists had advanced missile technology. Up close, they used turbo lasers and droid fighters. Despite all of this advanced technology, the battles we see during this time are reminiscent of naval battles of the Age of Sail, where large groaning warships would trade broadsides with one another. It was actually relatively common to see terrible tactics on both sides. The Jedi, especially in the earlier years of the war, were extremely inexperienced. During an attempt to break a blockade of Ryloth, the young Padawan Ahsoka Tano, who was barely a teenager, was given command of an entire fleet, which obviously led to disastrous consequences for the Republic. If that's not bad, then Anakin Skywalker, under the protection of a white flag, rams his capital ship into the enemy's capital ship, which basically breaks every rule in warfare the galaxy's ever made. On the Separatist side, you had good generals and admirals, but they were usually spread thin, and so most battles were orchestrated by low-quality tactical droids. While occasionally you would have brilliant commanders like Admiral Trench involved in a battle, most battles involved very inexperienced and stupid commanders who would just basically launch their forces at each other in this massive, glorious explosion of death and destruction. Good for the cameras, not for the soldiers involved. The same thing could be said about the ground campaigns. They were for the most part carried out without much strategy other than let's beeline to the objective and destroy everything along the way. This would of course be broken up by moments of individual bravery and skill and ability by force using generals who oftentimes led from the front and inspired their clone troopers to attempt the impossible. Anakin Skywalker, who was loved by his men, was famous for forgetting that his soldiers were not Jedi as well, and as a result, because of the clones' steadfast dedication to him, many of their numbers died doing what only a Jedi really should be doing. But ultimately, none of this actually mattered, which is kind of crazy. There was this larger metagame being played by Chancellor Palpatine. He was basically in charge of the grand campaign strategy for both sides. When the Galactic Empire rose out of the ashes of the Galactic Republic, the Separatist threat lingered around for some time longer, a convenient excuse for Palpatine to continue the growth of his massive military. We saw a very interesting shift in Imperial military doctrine from Republic military doctrine. For one, the massive carriers and their numerous fighters were swapped out for even larger battleships bristling with turbolasers and filled with a smaller amount of short-range cheap fighters like the TIE in-space superiority fighter. The clone troopers, who were without a doubt the finest infantry soldiers the galaxy had ever seen, were swapped out for the stormtroopers, who were just made up of civilians. This is because the clones took 8 years to grow and train, the stormtroopers maybe took a quarter of the time. With the Empire's real enemies more or less defeated, Emperor Palpatine turned the focus of the Imperial military away from exterior threats onto his own people. So now, instead of designing a military force that could work against an imposing military, Palpatine wanted a cheap military that could be expanded to a ridiculous size and watch over his entire territory. Palpatine didn't want to be loved, he wanted to be feared. And if you are going to control something with fear, you better constantly watch it, or else it's going to turn around and bite you in the ass the second you look away. The Tarkin Doctrine kind of put that mentality down on paper, and would influence everything from how designs looked to what kind of weapons were used. The Imperial-class Star Destroyer was massive, and had an unprecedented number of turbolasers on board. Despite the fact that it had no real targets except for maybe, you know, labor protests or a democracy movement on some Outer Rim territory. The Empire clearly was spread thin and could have done better with, say, 20 light cruisers that could cover 20 different systems, rather than one Star Destroyer that could only cover one. But park one Imperial-class Star Destroyer over a planet, and the people on the planet are very inclined to get their act together. The same thing could be said about the AT-AT, which was unnecessarily high and exposed, but presented a frightening image on the battlefield. Now, much of the Imperial strategy actually depended on the Star Destroyer. It wasn't just a battleship or a ship of the line, it was actually a forward operating base. It had everything you really needed to carry out a full military operation. They had dropships, prefabricated ground bases, supplies, munitions for a legion of stormtroopers, and all of its mechanized units. The only problem, as we mentioned before, was that the Star Destroyers were spread thin across the galaxy. At the height of the Empire, the Navy was said to have 25,000 Imperial-class Star Destroyers. There were, of course, other models like the Victory and large command ships, but the Galactic Empire easily had millions of populated systems within its borders, if not more. When the Rebel Alliance started to grow, it was actually relatively easy to avoid the Empire. I mean, the galaxy is massive, and there are plenty of holes within the Imperial's defensive network. A lot of fans will ask the question, why didn't the Empire just bring its entire fleet of ships, or at least a couple hundred of Star Destroyers, to make sure that the Rebellion can't win a battle or escape at places like Hoth, Yavin, or Endor? The problem was, every time you took one Star Destroyer off its station, you would leave numerous planets basically unguarded for Rebel attack or maybe some kind of homegrown terrorist organization. So when the Battle of Endor happened and they rounded up a dozen or so Star Destroyers, it probably left a few hundred Imperial worlds open to Rebel attack. Now, the Rebel Alliance was basically built for slash and run attacks, which were really effective against the Empire. Almost every Rebel starfighter was equipped with hyperdrives and didn't need to be deployed out of carriers when they entered battles. This meant that by the time the TIE fighters usually exited out of their ships in a battle, the X-Wings were already finished with their attack runs and on their way out of the system. What capital ships the Alliance had were also quite fast and maneuverable. The Rebellion understands what exactly works in a space battle. The Republic model of carrier-based fighters was the most efficient and dangerous naval force that could be assembled with technology at the time. A smart admiral knows to never fight the battle over your own fleet, fight it over the enemy's fleet. On the ground, the battle looked quite different from the almost Napoleonic battle formations that were common during the Clone Wars, and that's because Rebel fighters, Imperial troopers, and soldiers were normal sentient beings with a normal sense of preservation, and no one really wanted to die needlessly on a chaotic battlefield, which is why leaders that constantly got friendlies killed on both sides will most likely experience a tragic friendly fire incident. Especially if you look at the Rebel Alliance, which was hardly a disciplined military force, but more like a hastily put together band of criminals, and at best, a local militia. But even so, they were a band of criminals that knew how to use cover and flanking maneuvers and supporting fire, so that is kind of an evolution. While the Rebel Navy had its own disciplinary issues and no service contracts, basically, it did require a little more professional ability to be a part of a naval force than it would for a ground force. You actually had to know how to operate ships or fix them. Plus, many of the fighter pilots and officers in the Rebel Navy had defected from the Empire and were quite disciplined to begin with. You might not realize this, but Rebel fighters and Rebel pilots could basically come and go as they please because the Rebel Alliance didn't actually pay any people until they were the New Republic. And to be honest, they didn't really pay anyone in the earlier days of the New Republic either. So, yeah, if you're not getting paid, you don't have to fight. This meant that Rebel commanders usually sought moral and ideological victories over the Empire as much as they would seek strategic victories. The core leadership of the Rebellion understood that there was no way that they could defeat the Empire in the long term by just eliminating their ships and garrisons. Their long-term strategy was to inspire people to rise up against what they saw as a corrupt and inefficient regime. Their strategy worked. The New Republic demilitarized and then allowed hostile forces and influences to infiltrate their Senate. And they were ultimately destroyed in one massive laser attack. Now, I know a lot of people don't like the First Order or see it as a blatant ripoff of the Empire, but the way I see it, it's exactly what a hardcore Star Wars fan would do if he wanted to fix every mistake the Empire made, except for maybe one or two, and then create this Empire 2.0. That's what the First Order really is. I mean, if you look at it, they were able to create Star Destroyers like the Resurgent class that had a more protected bridge with redundant bridges built deeper into the ship. The Resurgents also had great point defense weapons. Even the TIE Fighters were more robust and featured shields, hyperdrives, life supports, and torpedoes. That would have been unheard of during the Imperial era. I mean, even the Stormtroopers had upgraded F-11D blasters, which had integrated scopes that fed into their helmets. J.J. Abrams clearly knows about the, you know, not hitting thing. Just look at how accurate these stormtroopers are when they're firing into a crowd of innocent terrorists. Of course, Starkiller Base was a mistake and probably ultimately flawed, but it actually did achieve its intended goal. It destroyed the New Republic and made everyone terrified to work with the New Republic. Plus, it actually had some improvements. First, they were smart enough to realize that they didn't have to actually build a moon-sized construct. When you build something that large, you can save a lot of credits and man hours by building it on an actual planet instead. Then there's the Resistance. They're basically the opposite of the First Order. They are in a worse situation than the Rebellion ever was, and they have pretty much the same ships and mentality, so it's kind of not even worth mentioning. Although it should be noted that whatever they have in a much smaller quantity than the Rebellion. Then let's go back to the First Order's ridiculous simultaneous Blitzburg thing they carried out on the entire New Republic. I mean, we're never really going to truly understand the scope of this assault, but it's incredible. I mean, I'm really sad about all the people who died, but it's incredible military strategy. Good job. This is not your father's empire, where bureaucracy and ultimately politics doomed the Imperial Navy just like it had doomed the Republic. The First Order is run by technocrats, individuals like Armitage Hux, who ran battles on spreadsheets and PowerPoints and Dungeons and Dragons. He was a master of building systems, including logistics. He was able to use math and science to clear away the fog of war. Every individual stormtrooper, TIE fighter pilot, mechanic was accounted for and directed to maximum efficiency. Plus, the First Order had a significant advantage over the Empire. This time around, they were the attacking force. They didn't have to defend any population centers or protect any resources. They could just do what their military was best created for, destroy things. Everything, including their barracks, training facilities, and even their shipyards were found within their fleet. The New Republic was destroyed before they could even launch a counterattack, and the Resistance is designed for guerrilla warfare, not defending planets from fleets of Star Destroyers. So as you can see, the Resistance are pretty much screwed, and of course, because it's Star Wars, the good guys will ultimately find a way to win, hopefully, because we all have to have that hope, and as much as I admire the First Order, I know they're evil, like, wouldn't want to live beneath them at all. Anyway, guys, let me know what you think about our history of Star Wars combat through all three trilogies. I know it's a lot to kind of compress, but it's kind of interesting how each phase had relatively different types of warfare because of how the social economic structure was set up and how the militaries were set up as well. Well, guys, don't forget to subscribe and hit that notification button down below. Also, guys, we're probably going to start a podcast relatively soon, so keep an eye out for that. We'll link it somewhere. Anyway, guys, thanks for joining us today. If you're watching this, you are Generation Tech.